Hi friends, today we are going to see the chapter 4, that is address mapping. As all of we know that a data packet may travel from source machine to the destination machine via several network or devices. For a data packet to be delivered to the correct machine, different addresses are used. So at the data link layer, we have seen we can make use of the MAC address or the physical address. The network layer make use of IP address for the internet working, and the transport layer make use of the port number for the process-to-process communication. So all these addresses are required for the communication between the source and the destination machine. We will consider one example. In that, a source machine creates a packet and wants to send a data packet to a machine with the IP address, with some IP address. So at that time, the network layer is going to be passed this data to the physical layer for the transmission purpose. So what the physical, it will pass to the data link layer for the transmission purpose. So what the data link layer will do now, so a packet is sent from the network layer with a given IP address for a particular destination. So data link layer will be applying the concept of framing on it. It will encapsulate that packet into a frame, and also it is going to be put what is the source MAC address and what is the destination MAC address. Source MAC address is known to the data link layer, but for the destination MAC address will be not known to the data link layer because the network layer has passed the IP address of the destination. So how the data link layer will now find out the MAC address of the destination? So for finding the MAC address of the destination machine, there is a need of one more protocol, which is finding the MAC address for the given IP address. So for a given IP address, if we want to be find out the MAC address, we have to be make use of the protocol, which is called as the address resolution protocol or the ARP. Similarly, when we need to find the logical address from the physical address. So we know the physical address, and now I want to be find out the logical address. So in that case, we require a protocol that is called as the reverse address resolution protocol. So the delivery of the packet to a host or a router requires a two level of addressing, that is the logical and the physical. So we need to able to map a logical address to its corresponding physical address or a physical address to a logical address. And this can be done using either the static or the dynamic mapping using the ARP and the reverse ARP. So already I have just given you the idea about what is the physical address. It is a local address that comes with the machine, which is called as a MAC address. And your logical address is the IP address, which is 32-bit IP address, that is the 4-byte. So when we want to map a IP address to a MAC address, we require the ARP. There are the two types of mapping that is supported by the ARP, that is the static mapping and the dynamic mapping. So what is going to be done in the static mapping? In the static mapping, each host has a configuration file in which mapping of IP address to the MAC address. So in this configuration file, statically, there is the mapping of the IP address to the MAC address is going to be done. But what is the limitation of the static mapping? A machine may change its network interface card. So in this case, the table has to be updated. So if machine is changing its network interface card, along with that, the MAC address will also change. So in that case, this information has to be updated into the mapping table. as well as it must be maintained and updated each time a machine moves from one network to the another. So whenever I am moving from one network to the another network, this information has to be maintained in the static mapping table where it is doing the mapping of the IP address to the MAC address. So there are the limitation of the static mapping, and that's why we have to be make use of the dynamic mapping. So in the dynamic mapping, each host maintains a dynamic table with the continuous table updation. So for how the continuous table updation is going to be done? It is going to be done with a learning mechanism. And for this, some protocol is going to be needed. So with the learning mechanism, these tables are going to be updated continuously. And so of course, the dynamic mapping is going to be useful as the tables are going to be dynamically updated. So for the dynamic mapping, we are having these two protocols, that is the ARP, address resolution protocol, and reverse address resolution protocol. So what the ARP is doing now, ARP is mapping the IP address to the MAC address. And what our ARP is doing, it is doing the mapping of the MAC address to the IP address. So both are the reverse of each other. So first we will see how the ARP is going to be working. So as we have already seen that this is a dynamic mapping protocol. Okay. This dynamic mapping protocol is used to associate the network layer address, such as the IP address, with a data link layer address. So ARP operations are going to be for the local host, how the ARP operation is going to be look like. So we are going to be see to that. So upper layer software builds a packet with the IP address of the source and the destination. The machine knows its own, and if they get passed this to the data link layer, every machine knows the MAC address of that machine, but it doesn't know the MAC address of the destination machine. And when it does not know, it is making use of the ARP. To make a ARP request to know what is the MAC address of the given IP address, a ARP broadcast message is going to be used. So just you can look into this diagram. So this is the ARP request, which is a broadcast type. So over here, there's a system A, there's a system B. Now a request is going to be broadcasted to all the machines. And what will be in the broadcast request? In the broadcast request, we know the IP address of the machine. So in the broadcast request, it will be broadcasted like this. Okay, what is the MAC address of the given IP address? So looking for the physical address for the node with the IP address, 144.23.56.23. So we want the MAC address of this machine. So this request is broadcasted to all. So whichever machine which is having the same IP address that is given in the broadcast request will be respond. And in the response, it will give its MAC address. So you can see that there's a system B which is having this IP address. So this system B is going to be responding with the MAC address. So your ARP request, you can see that this is a broadcast request. It is broadcasted to all, but whoever destination who receive, who is having this IP address will be response his own MAC address. And when it is responding, the reply is going to be unicast. So very important point, your request is a broadcast and your response is unicast in nature. So this way you can see the working of the ARP, how the ARP operation is going to be performed. So another important concept in your ARP is going to be ARP cache memory. So ARP cache memory is also very important. It is a very inefficient for a machine A to broadcast an ARP request for the every packet it wants to send. So for every packet, it is very difficult to send the ARP request packet. So in that case, to reduce the traffic, a ARP cache is used. So what is there in the ARP cache? Because for every request, I cannot, the finding out the same MAC address for this given IP address, every time I cannot send the ARP request packet. So what is going to be done for that is, the ARP cache is going to be used. And in this ARP cache, this is a table of logical to the physical address binding. And each host maintains a ARP cache to find the physical address of a machine. So every time when the request comes, first they look into the ARP cache if that mapping is available or not. If that mapping is available in the ARP cache at that time, the mapping will be taken from the ARP cache itself. Otherwise, if it is not available, in that case, the separate request has to be sent. So now we will see the packet format of your ARP. So ARP message use a relatively simple format. The total packet size is variable since the length of logical and the physical address may vary on different networks. So you can see that over here in this particular packet format, we are having the different fields. In this field, you can see there is a hardware type. This hardware type is nothing but a 16-bit field defining the type of the network on which the ARP is running. So it defines the type of network on which the ARP is running. Each LAN has been assigned an integer based on its type. For example, Ethernet has a type 1. So if I'm making use of the Ethernet, at that time, this type will be 1. So based on the network, this type are going to be changed. So most of the time it is going to be Ethernet, it is going to be of the type 1. The next field is going to be protocol type. This is a 16-bit field defining the protocol which requires the ARP request. So which is the protocol that requires the ARP request is going to be mentioned over here. For example, IPv4. So this is an internet protocol with a version 4. If it is used, it is going to be the protocol type value will be 0x0800. Okay, so if IPv4 is using the ARP at that time, it is going to be 0x0800. ARP can be used with any higher layer protocol. So as over here, we are talking about the network layer, and at the network layer, the IPv4 protocol is making use of the services of the ARP, and that's why the protocol type will be included with the 0x0800, that is for the IPv4. Next is the hardware length. So this hardware length specify the 8-bit field defining the length of physical address. And we know that as it is going to be the hardware, it is a MAC address. Your MAC address is the 6 bytes, which is 48 bits. Next is the protocol length. Protocol length is going to be giving you the, this is an 8-bit field. Again, it is going to be give you what is the length of the logical address that you are using. So we know we are having the logical address that is the 32-bit, that is a 4-byte logical address that is used and that can be specified over here. Next field is the operation. As we have seen, there are the two operations that is performed with the ARP. Either I am sending a request packet or either I am getting a reply packet. So your operation includes the request or reply. And the rest of the fields are self-explanatory, where we can specify what is the sender hardware address. So sender ka hardware address kya hai? Then what is the sender ka protocol address? What is the IP address of the sender? Then what is going to be the targeted IP address, which is the 4-byte? And what is going to be the target MAC address or the physical address that we don't know? And if I want to be find out, I can find out with a request packet. So I can specify it over here, the MAC address as well as the IP address in the different fields of your packet format. So you can see over here how the encapsulation of the ARP request is going to be done. So ARP request and reply packet are encapsulated into a data link layer frame, because the network layer is going to be pass its packet to the data link layer. And when it is passing to the data link layer is going to be just encapsulating that ARP request into the frame. We already studied the frame format of your traditional Ethernet. So in that we have studied what is the preamble field, what is the destination address, what is the source address, what is the type. Okay, so along with that, in your data, your ARP request packet, ARP request or reply packets are going to be encapsulated. So this way, the encapsulation is going to be done of your ARP packet into your data link layer frame. So this is how your ARP is going to be working. So now we will see what is different ARP operations. So in this ARP operation, the sender knows the IP address of the target. IP asks the ARP to create the ARP request message. So first, what is the steps? I know the IP address of the destination. My sender is asking the ARP to send a request message and find out what is the MAC address of the destination. This message is going to be encapsulated into the sender frame, where destination address is going to be a broadcast address, because my request message is going to be a broadcast. So it is broadcasted to all. When it gets broadcasted to all, the destination who is having that IP address is going to be respond with a unicast response. And in that it will specify what is the MAC address of the destination. So it will send a reply which is going to be unicast, and in that it will specify what is the MAC address of the destination. So this is the ARP operation that is going to be performed by the ARP protocol. So I suppose up to this point, everyone understood how the ARP works.